Hello, my name is Ursula Pike, and I am the author of OERigin Stories, Pathways to Open Education. I'm here to tell you a little bit about my project and hopefully inspire you to tell your own OERigin story. Before I tell you about the OER I created, I first want to tell you a little bit about me so you'll know why I created it. I work for the Digital Higher Education Consortium of Texas. I'm also an author and a creative writing instructor. I'm involved with the CCC OER's Equity, Diversity, and Inclusion Committee, and I'm a member of the Karuk tribe. Our homeland is on the Pacific coast near the California-Oregon border. So all these parts of my identity contributed to me wanting to create an OER that promoted equity, diversity, and inclusion, but I didn't know how best to do that. At Open Ed 19, before the pandemic and before the nationwide reckoning with race that happened in the summer of 2020, I saw a poster presentation by Melina Theed from SUNY Plattsburgh with this data right here on the lack of diversity in OER creation. This data is upsetting, not surprising, and sadly, actually a little bit better than traditional textbook publishing, which has even less diversity. To me, this was one of the most important presentations at Open Ed 19, but it wasn't until a year later when I began my Spark Open Education Leadership Program that I was able to do something to address it. I ask the participants of OERigin Stories 6 questions. Tell me about yourself and how you came to open education. How do you see your unique identities intersecting with open, if at all? Tell me about an open education project you've been involved with. I ask them how did they see their role in the future of open education. I ask them what the biggest benefit of open education was and what's missing. And then I ask them what questions they were grappling with related to open education. In response to the first question about how they were involved with OER in the first place, Tanja Connerly said, "My department chair came to me and asked." Shinta Hernandez said, "I became involved in the grant as a sociology professor." And Angela DeBarger said, "It started to click for me, the connection between what we wanted to accomplish and the intention of OER." How would you answer this question? How did you become involved with the open education movement? Were you invited in? Were you just curious? Were you handed the responsibility for OER? Was it something that you thought would be good for your career? There's no wrong answers here, but I think it's important to look at the answers to determine who are the gatekeepers, who are the bouncers, who are the doormen of open education, who let you in, and who are you helping, if by nothing more than your example. How would you answer this question? How do you see your unique identities intersecting with open, if at all? What are your identities? Are you a researcher, Cuban American, instructor? I ask the question because each of us contains a multitude of identities. I'm Native, but as I said in my introduction, I am also a creative writing instructor, and sometimes my desire to find openly licensed materials conflicts with my desire to provide my students with writing by diverse authors. I'll always choose diversity over open resources. I hate that I have to make that choice, but I'm okay with it. The next question I asked was, what do you think is the biggest benefit of open education, and what do you think is missing? Jesse Lawyer said, for Indigenous people, open access, especially related to our collections, can help us reunite with those relatives that are held in collections. Shinta Hernandez said, we can still improve. We can develop more accurate assessments. And Angela DeBarger said, open education can play a role in system transformation. I want to highlight one more response to this question. Ariana Santiago said, what's missing is balance. I think that can apply to our work in open education, and I know definitely I feel that sometimes applies to our work in equity, diversity, and inclusion. How would you answer this question? What do you think is the biggest benefit of open education? And what do you think is missing? We all know open education can save students money, but what other goals do you or your institution have that are addressed by open education? The final question that I asked the women in Origin Stories is, these are my questions, but what questions about open education are you grappling with? That's the question that I'm asking you right now. What's the question about open that no one has asked and that no one has asked you? So what's the point of my project, of my interviews, of Origin Stories as a whole? I have been asked how an instructor or an open education practitioner can use these stories to address equity. And the truth is, it's not a straight line. You can't say Angela DeBarger said this in Origin Stories, so we should do X. In diversity, equity, and inclusion in open research and education, Tara Roberts asks, who is missing? Who isn't even in the room? Who doesn't have a seat at the table? Who is sitting on the margins? Who doesn't feel welcome? Who has to fight to have their viewpoints respected? When I asked these questions about the open movement, it was clear to me that as a woman of color, I felt like I was sitting on the margins. So I created a project that centered women of color. I hope that the efforts of these leaders and many more who are working to transform education using open are recognized. I hope that this presentation has made you a little bit curious about Origin Stories. You can access the Google Doc of Origin Stories at my page on the Spark Open Education Leadership Program. Watch your favorite open education listserv because I'll be publishing the full resource via Pressbooks soon. I also hope you're inspired to tell your own origin story. Thank you, and please follow me or reach out on social media if you have questions.